Good morning. Welcome and thank you for joining us in worship this morning. Grateful that you're here. Hey, if you're here, I would love for you guys to be able to, for us to see your faces. So if you're open, willing, turn your cameras on so we could see you. Turn your cameras on so as we worship together, we are able to see each other and sing and declare the Lord's goodness and faithfulness together. Thank you for being with us this morning, whether you're watching on Zoom with us or whether you're on YouTube or Facebook. I'm glad you're here. Take a moment. If you've seen the intro question for us as we wait during the intro video, the question in the chat is, hey, where in the world would you love to travel? Introduce yourself if you're new. Tell us who you are and tell us where you would love to travel as we do the intro video. So we're going to take a few moments and we're going to take the intro video, and that gives you some time to be able to get your things that you need for service this morning. So if you don't have your Bible yet, go grab your Bible. If you don't have a notebook to take notes, go do that. It's great to take notes of sermons. If you don't have communion elements, go ahead and grab those as well. And then we'll do the intro video afterwards. We'll begin the service this morning. So Kevin, would you play the video for us? This morning, thank you for joining us and being with us this Morning, as we gather and declare that this is the day that the Lord has made, that we will rejoice and be glad in it. And so as we come this morning, we all come with different weights, different burdens, different concerns, but we come to the one who is strong enough, able enough, and cares enough to carry all of those for us. And so as we come to Jesus this morning, as we pray, I want to invite you to prepare your hearts and ask Jesus to just refresh you, renew you, strengthen you in the gospel this morning. So would you pray with me? And after we pray, our brother Camden is going to read our scripture portion this morning. Father, we thank you for this morning as we gather. Would you prepare our hearts, our souls, our minds to encounter our Creator, our Savior, the one who loves us and gave his life for us. Father, would you remove any distractions from our lives? Would you remove any worries or burdens so that we could keep our eyes fixed on Jesus for these just few minutes as we keep our eyes fixed on you, to be reminded that you're bigger than anything that we're worried about or concerned about, that you are in control. And so God, be glorified in this morning's service. Would you, in every aspect of this service, would Jesus be lifted up and glorified? Thank you for your kindness to us. Father, we love you. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Camden, would you lead us in the reading of God's word?
I'm going to read from Psalm 51. Be gracious to me, God, according to your faithful love, according to your abundant compassion. Blot out my rebellion. Surely you desire integrity in the inner self, and you teach me wisdom deep within. Purify me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Turn your face away from my sins, and blot out all of my guilt. God, create a clean heart for me, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore the joy of your salvation to me, and sustain me by giving me a willing spirit.
Thank you, Camden. If y'all haven't figured this out by now, I'm a big fan of the church calendar year, the liturgical year, and we are in a season of Lent right now, leading up to Easter. As y'all probably know, Lent starts with Ash Wednesday, which is when we sort of remember that from dust we come and to dust we return. So this season of Lent invites us to reflect on our humanity, to reflect on our brokenness and our need for a Savior. And so Camden just read a really beautiful psalm of repentance and of confession. And so I just want to invite y'all, as we sing this opening song, to prepare our hearts for worship, to just reflect on that, to reflect on our humanity, to reflect on our brokenness, and to recognize that that God alone is holy, and that we have this opportunity this morning to gather in community and to worship him and recognize his holiness.
All the poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, all the thieves will come confess. With nothing left.
Amen. Thank you, Todd, Katie, for leading us in worship this morning. I'm going to give a few announcements and then we will go into breakout rooms. Just a couple of quick announcements. One, first and foremost, thank you so much for all of you guys that helped us with the anniversary service last weekend. What a joy to remember God's faithfulness and goodness to us as a church over the last 10 years. So thank you for being a part of that service, whether you've helped with that or just being part of our church community. Just grateful for you guys. It's been a while since we've done Zoom. And so when sermon happens this morning, we are going to have a separate Zoom service for our kids. And so the link, Katie's going to put it in the chat, but it's also in the email. So if you've got kids, would love for our kids to participate in Kids Church this morning. And so make sure you click on the link. Also, thank you for helping us with the surveys the last couple of weeks on the conversations of regathering and what that looks like. We're really grateful to hear input from so many of you guys. And we are taking all of that. We are wrestling through that, praying and having good conversations with the medical committee on what any of that looks like. And so just really grateful to be able to hear input from you guys. So thank you for that as well. By the way, if you're not on our email list that we just send out weekly reminders of what service is going to look like and all that, would you let us know? Would love to connect with you. So if you could just shoot an email to info@loftcitychurch.com and just let us know that you need to be on the email list. We'll make sure you're on the email list, but would love for you to be able to stay connected with the church body. One of the best ways to stay connected is through our community groups and Bible studies. We've got three specific community groups that gather based on location: Richardson, Dallas, and Collin. And the times are listed there on the screen. If you're not in a community group and you desire to be in one, community groups are just times for us to catch up, hang out, learn. A lot of the community groups are doing specific studies right now. And so I'm taking advantage of these Zoom opportunities. And so if you're not in a community group and want to connect in one, please shoot an email out to info@loftcitychurch.com and would love to get you plugged in as well. The same goes for Bible studies. Bible studies are opportunities for a handful of men, handful of women to get together, study God's word, check in on each other, hold each other accountable. So if you're not in a Bible study and you're wanting and desiring to be in one, shoot us an email. We will get you connected to the right Bible study so that you can continue to grow in your walk with Jesus, but also build relationships with your church body as well. It's time for us to go into breakout rooms. We've got about 13 minutes in this breakout room. So would love for you guys to share what's been going on in your lives and to pray for each other. So take advantage of the time to share, but make sure you have opportunities to pray as well. So don't miss out on the opportunity to pray together with your church body as well. So we'll go into breakout rooms now, and then we'll come back and do testimonies and hear just what God is doing in each of our lives afterward as well. So Awesome. Well, welcome back. Good to see you guys. Give me 1 second. It's time for us to be able to go into an opportunity to share our testimony, share what God is doing in our lives. So if you have a story of God's faithfulness in your life, if you have a prayer request, maybe you have a scripture verse that God encouraged you with this week and you want to bless the church body. So we're going to take just a few moments and we're going to invite you to be able to share. And so if you have something, feel free to unmute yourself and share with your church body.
Oh, hey guys, it's Ing here, and we're all the way in Alaska, so good morning. We got to go to Alaska for just an emergency reason. My brother and his wife, they're both in the medical field here. They had to return to work, and so we're here taking care of our nephew. But we are returning today, so just we would love prayers. We're flying out at 1 a.m., and it's going to be a 9-hour flight back to Dallas, and so with the little ones, we don't know what that's going to be like. But I did want to share with you guys from Psalm 90. I'll just try to read it really fast for you guys. I'm going to start with verse 12. It says, "So teach us to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. Satisfy in the morning with your steadfast love. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, and for as many years as we have seen evil. Let your work be shown to your servants and your glorious power to their children. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands upon us." Yes, establish the work of our hands. And so it's just really fitting, you know, the people are going through suffering and we're still in a place where we don't know what's gonna happen and what's going on with COVID and what life is gonna look like, but we know who our God is. And so just wanna encourage you guys that we can still pray for his steadfast love to see us through. And it's so good to see you guys this morning.
Thank you, brother. Praying for your travels as well this morning. Someone else.
Hey, man, Alaska, that's cool. Anyways, so this week I got the opportunity to share my story with some people and it was quite nerve-wracking. You know, there are just things in my life that that produce a lot of shame in my life. So I was like pretty nervous about it, but just like praying through it and stuff, God was giving me lots of grace and kind of directed me to the verse in Colossians. Basically, Colossians 3, 1 through 4. So it says, "If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, you also appear with him in glory." And I think that's just like a reminder for me when I'm in my head too much and like reading the news too much, like I just need to remember that like my life is hidden in Christ, right? That like I'm being renewed every single day, like every day. And that's hard when you're in a pandemic and you don't see nobody, you know? So I think God was just really gracious in giving me and directing me towards his truth, you know? And I think, and if you needed to hear this, I know I needed to really hear this week, but basically God was like, Victoria, you belong, you know, like you're free and I love you very much. So if you need to hear that, like, yeah, you're free, you belong and you're loved like a lot. So, yeah.
Amen. Thank you, sister. One more.
Hey, Pastor Sam, this is Martell. So I shared in our breakout room just yesterday, I was feeling a little bit discouraged. I'm not sure why, but happened to go take Grace to play video games, like a bowling alley. And then I happened to see Brother Steven there. And then like God just, I guess, coordinated that time because he was there at the same moment and had some of the same feelings. And then we just, you know, were able to encourage each other and we played like laser tag. You know, it's maybe, it was just unexpected because I just think that whenever there's a time of doubt, it seemed like God is always right on time or just in time. So I just wanted to share that.
That's awesome. Praise God for community. Praise God that he knows exactly what we need when we need it. So I want to take a few moments to pray. This week, gunmen killed 8 people at spas in Atlanta. And I don't want to get into the politics of this, of whether this is racism or something else, but all I know is there's an Asian American community that is grieving, that is hurting, that is in fear. I shared our story on a conference call yesterday. When we moved into a house in Philly, our house was getting vandalized every day simply because we were different. And it gave us 2 reactions immediately. It was fear and anger. And watching the events of this week, those were the 2 emotions that stirred up in my heart of fear and anger. And so what we need is to be reminded that there is hope in the midst of this. 1 Corinthians 12 reminds us that, compares the global body, global church to the physical body. 1 Corinthians 12, 26 says, if one part of the body suffers, all the other parts suffer with it. And so we want to invite, I want to invite you to suffer with our Asian American brothers, sisters. And here's what I want us to pray. I want us to pray that God, that we would seek your nearness for the families and friends grieving the loss of their loved ones, that they would feel your comfort and peace in the midst of this, that God, we would lament with you and with our Asian brothers and sisters over this violence and terror, and that God, we would repent of our pride, our biases, and our earthly desires, and that that you would cleanse our hearts. And then finally, that God, we would ask you to build unity in the church, so that believers stand in solidarity with each other in times of celebration and in times of sorrow. There's a community that's grieving. There's a community that's in fear. Brothers, sisters, we are called to grieve with them. We are called to weep with them. And so I wanna invite us to pray. And this is gonna be a little risky, but for the next 5 minutes, if you are open to unmuting yourself and praying, I would love for you to do that. So we will pray together corporately. Let's pray for God to bring peace, to God to bring healing, for God to bring unity in the church. So if you are uncomfortable praying, close your eyes and just pray where you are. But if you are open and willing to unmute and pray publicly, would you do that as well?
Father, Lord, we come to you asking for healing in our hearts, Lord. We are grieving the loss of 8 lives, Lord, and we are tired of seeing injustice happen. We're tired of people being killed senselessly. Please, please help our Asian community to feel your love. Help people in power to stand up for their rights, so that this doesn't happen again, Lord. I pray, Lord, that through this, we as a church and all the churches around the United States of America come together to stand up against injustice, and that we can meet the needs of different communities where it's needed, Lord. Please help us to all address areas in our lives where we don't speak up against prejudice, violence, racism, or please give us the courage to speak up even when it seems like it's a small aggression, Lord. Please help us all to know, just give us all your word, your encouragement, so we can help each other, Lord. Give us your word that'll bring encouragement, that'll bring strength, that'll bring love into people's lives, Lord. In your name I pray, amen.
Heavenly Father, I pray for the families of the eight individuals who were senselessly killed this past week. I pray that you'll be with them, that you'll bring healing, that you'll protect, guide them, and provide for those families. God, I pray for the Asian community who has faced a lot of insensitive hate crimes over this past year, whether it may be as small as being scapegoated for the current pandemic, being hurled insults at, or being spat on, as a lot of my friends have faced that, to having older Asians being attacked publicly on the streets, to what happened earlier this week. God, we just pray for our Asian community, for people to stand up with them, and just a prayer of comfort for Asian brothers and sisters to feel safe, to acknowledge that this is something to be upset about. And I just pray that our leaders in higher positions can bring forth legislation to try to help reduce and restore humanity for our Asian brothers and sisters.
God, you know the darkness. You know it really well, God. You know the darkness that is in our hearts and souls and minds, God. The fear, God, that takes over. The anxiety, God. The, the decision, God, I think that many Asian Americans here, Pacific Islanders here, Lord, decide to do, Lord, is to not speak. God, is to not rock the boat, is to just pretend like it didn't happen, Lord, so that there is peace, God. But you know, God, that that is false peace. And I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that that we would empower those that are vulnerable, God, especially the older generation, God, that have, frankly, PTSD from all the other stuff that they endured, evil that they endured in their home countries, God, and they came to America, Lord, to seek freedom, God. And we know that it's not perfect, and we know that they're not the only race, God, that has felt this way of trying to survive every day in a country that seems to not want you, Lord, and again, that's a general thing, but still, Lord, like there are just certain words and certain, you know, implicities, God, that's really harmful, God. And I know this firsthand, and I know this for my mom, and I know this for my dad and my relatives, God, and it hurts, Lord. And I don't think I really understand how to process it, God. I don't really understand. I don't understand a lot of things, God. So would you just help us to be a community, help us to lift each other up, help us to bring about real peace, God, that our anger would fuel peace, God, that our sadness would fuel peace, Lord, and that your love, God, would cast out fear, because there's so much fear right now, God. And I think at times it does feel hopeless. So God, would you just restore us, God, and bring about justice.
God, I just want to pray especially for those Asians in our community, those who are of Asian descent, Lord, and for our precious daughter, Lucy, who is was born in China, that all these that we know and love, God, that you would especially just put a hedge of protection around them, God, and just protect them from any evil, from any harm. And God, I pray that you would just heal our nation, just bring a spirit of unity, just sweep the hearts of the people of our nation with your love, God, with your peace, to just do a revival, just create a revival in our hearts, Lord, that we would serve you and we would love all individuals and value all individuals, regardless of their ethnicity. Just heal this cancer that's in our nation, Lord, and just unite us in your love. In Jesus' name.
Father, we do pray against this cancer. We pray that you would heal our land. Father, racism and attacks on ethnicities, on people based on their ethnicities, is not something that legislation is going to fix. Only a sovereign God who can change hearts can fix this. And so God, we as your church humbly ask, would you revive this nation? Would you take hearts that are full of hatred, and would you allow them to encounter the love of Jesus and transform their lives so that they would begin to love others just as you love them. Father, for our Asian American brothers and sisters, specifically for our Asian American brothers and sisters who are part of our LOFT community, I pray that today they would know that they are loved, that we love them, that we care for them. But more than that, I pray that they would hear that you love them, that you care for them. I pray that as we grieve with them, that we would hear their fears, their concerns, and we would lament and we would encourage. And Father, we would point them to you. God, we come broken. We come weeping, and we come trusting in you in the midst of this. So God, we thank you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you that you are working even in the midst of this pain and hardship. And we give our lives and we give all of this into your hands this morning. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. It's time for us to be able to give of our tithes, our offerings, as we worship God through our giving. And as we do, I want to invite you to prayerfully ask Jesus how he's calling you to give and be obedient to Jesus. You hear me say this all the time. We're not telling you what to give. We just want you to be obedient to the Holy Spirit that resides in you. And so would you prayerfully listen to him this morning, and as he leads you, would you give? We're going to sing a song and as we go into this time of giving. And then after that, Christine is going to read our portion of scripture. But I also want to invite, if you've got kids, this is a great time for them to jump on the Zoom call with Katie and Kids Church. So Anil, would you lead us in worship?
Thanks, Sam. So I want to invite you all to sing this song with me. It's called Break Our Hearts. I think it's exactly what Sam has just been talking about as we spent that time in prayer, just asking the Lord to break our hearts for what breaks his, and asking him to restore us. Break our hearts.
break a heart. We cry out, we need your hand. Come back to our land. We confess we lived in sin. Once again, break our hearts, oh God, break our hearts, break our hearts, oh God. Break our hearts for the sin in our lives. Break our hearts for the sin in our.
Before Christine reads the word, our speaker this morning is Morgan Matei. If you have not heard Morgan before, you guys are in for a treat, and we're excited to have her minister from God's word to us this morning. And so Christine will read the text this morning, and then Morgan will minister to us from God's word.
Second Timothy 2:14-19. Remind them of these things and charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have swerved us from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some. But God's firm foundation stands, bearing this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity.
Amen. Thank you, Christine. All right. So, can everyone see me and hear me all right? This is my first time to present on over Zoom. So, good morning, LOFT. My name is Morgan, and And I'm so excited to share with you this morning from God's Word. So, we're going to continue our study of 2 Timothy. And that's the book that we've been studying since the beginning of this year, I think. And I'm going to read it again in just a minute, and I'll pray for us at that time. But before we get started, I just wanted to talk about something that came to my mind when I first read this passage that Christine just read for us. So Paul warns against petty arguments about words and irreverent chatter. And the example that immediately popped into my head was, well, the internet, and specifically social media, and even like the comment sections on online. So have you guys seen the popcorn emoji and how people use it? So what happens is, like, if someone posts something that is maybe a little provocative or maybe is controversial, then like people might get offended about something. And you might see someone post in the comments, like a popcorn emoji, and they say, "I'm here for the comments." Like they see that something is about to go down and they're like, all right, like someone's about to get upset. There's going to be an argument. So I'm going to grab my popcorn and I'm going to sit back and I'm going to enjoy the show. Like, it's just like, it's just entertainment. Y'all know what I mean? Things can get pretty ugly out there online, and sometimes it's hard for us to turn away from it. But is this just the internet, or maybe this that happens online, all that the ugliness that we witness, it also displays certain things about human nature. It displays that we maybe tend to be argumentative and easily offended. We have this morbid desire to be right all the time, and we think negatively about anyone who has a different opinion than ours. Even if we don't like being at the center of drama, most of us don't, but we're still drawn to it. And we're easily distracted from the truth by these things that divide us. And we overlook truth in favor of things that are more entertaining or more appealing to our desires. So that's part of us as humans. The internet wasn't around, obviously, in 67 AD when Paul was writing this letter to Timothy. So I'm gonna tell you right now that Paul was not talking about internet popcorn when he wrote this passage. He was talking about something much bigger. You see, just like us, Paul and Timothy lived in a noisy world. Even in the early church, there were many different ideas and words and messages circulating that ran contrary to the gospel of Jesus. And those things sought to turn people away from God's word and from sound doctrine. And so in our verses today, Paul is saying to Timothy, hold on to God's word. In a noisy world, God's worker is the one who remains faithful to God's truth. And that's our message today. So at this time, if you need to, feel free to get up and go get some popcorn to munch on. You're probably at home. No one's going to know. I certainly won't see you. So I'm not saying that this sermon will be as entertaining as your favorite TV drama. However, I will say that God's word is much more valuable and worthwhile. God's word, all anywhere in scripture, has beauty and power that can transform us, that brings us closer to God, making us more like him. Let me pray for us real quick, and then I will read. So Jesus, thank you so much for this opportunity to learn from you this morning. I ask that at this time you would take away all of our distractions, God, and help us to see your truth clearly. Help us to be reminded of your gospel, and help us to find comfort there and confidence and boldness to follow after you alone. And it's in your name that I pray. Amen. All right, I'm going to read from the ESV once again. Starting in verse 14, he says, remind them of these things and charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have swerved from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some. But God's firm foundation stands, bearing this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. All right, so remember, this is a letter written from Paul to Timothy. Paul was writing from prison towards the end of his life, probably knew that he was about to die soon. He was writing to Timothy, who's one of his disciples, dearly loves, and Timothy is a pastor of a church at Ephesus. And I want us to think of our passage today, kind of, I want you to imagine like a triangle or a mountain, because we're going to see that there's an opening and a closing statement in this passage that forms the base of our triangle. If you go up the triangle a little bit, or the mountain, the mountains, by the way, is where I would prefer to vacation. That is always my choice over the beach. So we go up the mountain a little bit, and we have this negative command that Paul says. He says, don't quarrel about words. We go up to the peak of the mountain, and we have this positive command. He says, do your best to present yourself an approved worker. Come back down, another negative command. He says, avoid irreverent babble. And then we come back down to the base, where he talks about God's firm foundation. So that's the structure that we're going to follow for our passage. And there's three things that we're going to see about how does a worker stay faithful to God's truth in this noisy world. Number one, he remembers the gospel. Number two, we avoid gospel distractions. And number three, we preach God's word in speech and in action, both of those. So starting with verse 14a, he says, remind them of these things. Remember, so remind. So who are the people that Paul is maybe talking about? Probably he's referring to the faithful men already mentioned at the beginning of this chapter that Timothy was supposed to invest in so that they could teach others. But in instructing Timothy in his ministry, Paul is also instructing the entire church at Ephesus. And those instructions are for us today also as God's church and God's workers. So we are also the people who need to be reminded of these things. Now, what things? Looking at the passage right before, we see remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead and descended from David. That is like just a few verses earlier. And then we have the trustworthy saying, if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. And so what are those things? That's the gospel. That's the good news of God. In the next chapter, Paul says all scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching. And he encourages Timothy to continue in what he has learned and firmly believed. You see, all of scripture tells the story of the gospel. And anything in line with the story is told in God's word is sound doctrine or sound teaching. And Paul says to remind them of this. So to remind is to tell someone something they already know or have known. And a lot of our preaching on Sunday morning, or when you preach to yourself, when you encourage other people in your small group, or just people in your family, a lot of times you're telling them things that they already know. So we're teaching people how to walk according to what they say they believe. We might say it in a different way or use different illustrations, but the message, the unchanging truth of Jesus and his gospel remains the same. And we must always return to that. God's worker must remember what God has said and what we believe from the beginning. Now, paying attention to things we've already learned can be difficult. Our brains are literally wired for novelty. And while that can be a good thing, it can also be exploited in things like social media. That's why scrolling through social media can be so addictive. One of the reasons is that you get a shot of dopamine, your brain does, whenever you come across new information. So that's why it can be hard sometimes to like keep on going back to that thing that you already know. But God says, pay attention to this. Remember what I have done for you. Remember what I have said. The word of God, we need to read scripture over and over. So this is not just like a one and done, remind them once and then you're done, but it's a constant thing. Reminding ourselves of the gospel must be part of our regular practice. And that's part of the base of our triangle. All right, we're going to go up the middle section of our triangle. We're going to look at the second half of verse 14. And we're going to combine that with verses 16 through 18, which are on the other side, also in the middle section. And this is where Paul is saying, avoid the gospel distractions. So a distraction is something that turns people away from sound doctrine, from the sound doctrine or the message of Jesus, the gospel that is found in scripture. So verse 14 says, charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. So like almost any group of people, it seems like the early church tended to quarrel over things. They had some arguments. And in fact, this command from Paul, we see like throughout multiple times in these letters, especially these letter, these pastoral letters here. And the dictionary defines quarrel as to disagree angrily, squabble, or wrangle. I had to go and look that up for myself when I was studying this, because I was like, well, what does that mean? Like, if we're supposed to, you know, sometimes we do have to confront people about certain words, like that's okay. But no, this refers to a type of arguing. And he's saying this type of fighting over words, it does no good. It only ruins the hearers. Like these are arguments that they don't go anywhere. They don't do anything. They don't do any good for either those who engage in them or for those who listen. In fact, they lead to ruin. Fighting over words, especially non-essential issues, things that are not part of the gospel, it just drowns out the good stuff. It drowns out the sound doctrine, the truth of the gospel. So like if a preacher is too busy responding to every opponent's challenge and question about words, when will the gospel be preached? And do these kind of arguments really teach people truth? Think about it. Like Paul says it ruins the hearers. In an angry squabble, the squabblers, which I think I made that word up, but the squabblers are working to benefit the hearers and fight for truth? Or is it more about trying to prove a point or complain about something? You see, a teacher who wants to teach well must keep in mind the best interest of the student. And even in a debate, you must pay attention to what listeners are hearing. In an angry argument, even if there are true things being said, that truth is not what people are hearing. It is not what they are going to take away with them. Now, Paul is not saying, again, that we should not challenge people over what they say or confront false teachers. On the contrary, later in this book of 2 Timothy, he charges Timothy to use scripture to rebuke and to correct people. So that's a little different from quarreling. Now, so if you are, if you do feel led to confront someone or something, I encourage you to ask yourself two things. Number one, ask yourself, is this essential to the gospel, what I'm arguing, or is it just going to distract people from the things that are important? Number two, assess your motives. Are you arguing to win just to feel that you came out on top, just to feel justified or superior over the other person? Or are you rather instructing your opponent with gentleness and patience out of love for them instead? So those are two things to think about when we are maybe think we might need to argue or debate about something. Let's look at the other gospel distraction. Now we're going to go to the other side of our mountain, verses 16 through 18. It says, avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have swerved from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some. So in addition to quarrels, Paul says to avoid this irreverent babble, which we're not quite sure what he means by that, but other versions say worldly and empty chatter, or irreverent and empty speech. So this is the kind of speech that's empty because it has no truth in it. It is often associated with what Paul calls the false teachings or the false teachers that are circulating these lies within the church. So these are teachings that don't agree with the truth of the gospel revealed in scripture. Now sometimes, maybe even often, this type of irreverent babble, it doesn't start out as a well-developed idea or teaching. It might start out with like a little babble over here and a little babble over there, nothing big, just some like subtle twisting of the truth. But look at where it leads in scripture. It says it leads to more and more ungodliness, spreading like gangrene in the body. So gangrene is tissue death that is caused by lack of blood flow or infection in the body. It can happen anywhere, and it can lead to death if it's not treated. It can be a very serious thing. Other translations suggest the word cancer here, giving the idea of a deadly disease that spreads and becomes deadlier as it spreads. And guys, that is what happens when these kinds of ideas, even like ones that don't sound that bad right at the beginning, but if it is not in line with Jesus and his gospel, this is what can happen. This is what happens when it spreads in the body of Christ. It's the church. It leads to like the death of the tissue, and like whole body parts become not even functioning well because the tissue has died. So how about these guys? We'll call them Haim and Phil that Paul mentions. So these are men that Timothy probably would have been, or he would have been familiar with. He knows them. And most likely they had swerved from the truth to a Greek philosophy that doesn't believe in bodily resurrection, but only spiritual. Now, this was a big deal. That was a very problematic teaching in the church. And Paul devotes a large chunk of 1 Corinthians 15 in demonstrating that the bodily resurrection of Jesus and thus believers is essential to Christian doctrine. But he doesn't need to go into that here in 2 Timothy, because the point here is to remind Timothy what can happen when people engage in that irreverent babble. He says, look at where it led these guys and people that followed him. It says that they suffered shipwreck in regards to their faith. He says that in 1 Timothy. And so I asked the question, like, well, why, you might ask a question, why do these things spread so much? Like, what causes these false ideas to spread, like gangrene or cancer, which like are very, they spread very easily. And it could be for several reasons, but for one thing, they might appear more attractive than the gospel for a time. So the gospel, while great news, definitely has some hard parts. Like that part about sin, maybe, or the part about suffering. And so Paul's in prison, right? He's devoted his entire life to advancing the gospel. And here he is at the end of his life, deserted by friends in jail. And he's still saying, follow me, guys, like follow me and following Jesus, join with me in suffering. But maybe these other guys are over here saying, this life is all you've got, and God wants to bless you now so that he can make your life easy now. And so, like, which one sounds better? Do you see why people might be led astray? Maybe they also spread because they're subtle. Lies and false teachings don't usually come with a big label saying false, although I know Facebook is working on that. Many lies sound good because they have bits of truth in them. Notice that the text says they swerved from the truth. These guys started out saying the right things and people followed them comfortably, thinking they knew what they were talking about. But then they started to drift off course. And that drift can be subtle. And people might not even be aware that it's happening. And yet that drift toward ungodliness, it leads people down paths that upset their faith, even shipwrecking their faith. Guys, there's danger in just even like little irreverent babble. And it's not the teaching itself, but it's the ruin that it causes in the lives of people that listen to it. And this wasn't just an issue in the early church. We are also surrounded by so many things, voices and messages around us that are trying to throw us off course. They're trying to distract us from the gospel. I have a few, just a few of them that I'm going to list for you guys, but there are plenty more. One of them that we might hear today is this idea that if I follow Jesus, I deserve to have a nice retirement and just, you know, that's just the goal of life, is to follow the rules, work hard, and then I get to enjoy retirement and God's going to bless me. So that is maybe not preached explicitly, but it's a cousin to the prosperity gospel that is preached. And so that is something that we might hear that in subtle ways that we need to be on guard against and avoid it. Another one that we hear is the idea that God wants us to be happy. Therefore, we should do whatever it takes to make us happy, even if it means bending some of his commands. Right. And that's a false teaching that we need to avoid. This other one is one that I almost didn't want to include because I'm like, there's like no truth in it at all. But it is the lie of white supremacy there's no way that it started in the truth. It was just a blatant lie that crept its way into the truth. It even crept its way into the churches. It was preached from the pulpit not that long ago. Maybe even it is still today. I don't know. And that is a dangerous teaching that even though it can be a little bit more subtle these days, but it continues to cause so much damage and ruin. And the effects of it are tragic and heartbreaking. And it is a deadly disease that is present in the body of Christ. And that's something that we need to avoid.
Preach this.
All right. So now we talked about gospel distractions. Let's go to the peak of our mountain here. This is the third point today. Verse 15, Paul says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. So Paul tells us what we're not supposed to do, but now he's telling it what it looks like when we avoid those gospel distractions. So he says, do your best, make every effort, be diligent, make this the most important thing in your life, because if you're focused on this, you're less likely to be distracted. So what are we focused on? We're focused on presenting ourselves to God. Like that soldier in verse 4 that I think we talked about a few weeks ago, he only seeks to please his commanding officer. So the worker of God seeks to please God. Now, guys, every day we work to present ourselves in a certain way. Maybe not as much since COVID, but here's what I mean. When you go to work, you make sure that you present yourself according to the expectations of your workplace. Same at school. This means you dress a certain way. You make sure that you've bathed at least somewhat recently and your hair doesn't look sloppy. You also present with certain attitudes such as eagerness and excitement or grumpiness. And that takes a little bit of effort to try to get ready and present yourself in a certain way. Now think about this. What about a bride presenting herself on her wedding day? Think about all the preparation that goes into that presentation. It usually starts months ahead of time by choosing a dress, a hairstyle, and someone to do your makeup, and then practicing the hair and makeup. And then the big day comes, and it takes all day to get ready just for that moment of presentation at the ceremony. So I think us presenting ourselves to God is more like a bride presenting herself to her husband in love and anticipation than maybe it is about presenting to work for your boss. The presentation matters a lot more. It's a lot more important. And hopefully her husband is going to accept and approve of her regardless of any imperfections in her presentation. So God does love us despite our imperfections, and we are far from perfect for sure. But also notice in our passage today, we're told to present ourselves as one approved, an approved workman. So let's go back months and maybe years even before that wedding, those two people went on a first date. And each person likely worked very hard to present themselves well at that first date. Now, that wasn't out of love at that time. That was because there was a real possibility of rejection if they messed up. They could either be accepted or rejected, approved or denied. And guys, God does not approve of the mishandling of his word. He does not approve of lies and false teaching and quarreling and things that lead to ruin and division in his church. The people that engage in those kind of things ought to be ashamed. This passage mentions shame. So far in this letter of 2 Timothy, Paul has spoken of shame before other people. He says to Timothy, don't be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. And I'm not ashamed, referring to his suffering for the gospel. He's saying that preaching God's word, even if it leads to suffering, is not a reason to be ashamed. Now, his suffering led other people to be ashamed of him, but that was shame before men. But who do we present to? We present to God. We stand before God. He is the one who approves of our work. So Paul has no need to be ashamed of the gospel, even though his fight for it landed him alone in prison. He knows he stands before God, and it doesn't matter what other people say. He has rightly handled the word of truth. So that's the last part of this verse. And the literal word for that rightly handled is, it's a compound word, and it means to cut straight. So we don't know if there was a specific image that Paul had in mind here, but it could refer to any number of things. It wasn't the word just like for teaching or preaching. He literally says, cut straight the word of truth. This could mean, it could be refer to someone plowing a field who must make sure his lines are arranged just right so that the crops fit correctly into the field. It could be someone cutting a road who needs to make sure that they're cutting in the right direction towards the intended destination and safely avoiding dangers like swamps and cliffs. You don't want to like cut a road off a cliff. That would not be good. And another example is a swordsman who practices endlessly to make sure that he wields that weapon accurately, right? It's not good if he like accidentally chops off his own arm or the arm of an ally. He needs to make sure that he is cutting accurately. He is handling, rightly handling or cutting straight. So that's what the text means. And this is the kind of care and thought and devotion that God's worker must show when handling God's word. Mishandling God's words, as we see from those examples, have serious consequences. And I like the word handling here. Some versions might say teaching, but I like the word handling because I think it helps us see that this is more than just preaching God's word. It's more than just what we say. We need to be faithful to the gospel in what we say, of course, but we also preach to ourselves, and the truths that we tell ourselves impact how we conduct our lives. It affects what we do and how we live. So take a look. We're going to start moving down to the base of our triangle. We're going to start looking at that last verse. And I want you to notice real quick, what's the last thing it says? It says, let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. So an approved worker handles God's word rightly in both word and action. Imagine a preacher who works so hard to present the right interpretation of scripture in every one of his sermons, and he does a really good job at it. His words are technically correct, but his life doesn't reflect any of that. And so what will God say when that preacher stands before him? Will God say, well, I know you didn't obey any of my other commands, and your life was really not what I had in mind for my followers, but everything you said in your sermons was true, so you're good. But no, of course not. What we do matters. Irreverent babble leads to ungodliness. Sound doctrine and correct teaching, that leads to godliness. And so we need to preach God's word in our God's truth in our words and our actions. Let's look at that full verse. It says, God's firm foundation stands bearing this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Guys, in a noisy world, it can feel like God's worker is fighting a losing battle. Sometimes it feels like the truth of the gospel is being drowned out by all the noise. The threat of these arguments and divisions in the church, whether it's our local church or the church as a whole, it can cause us to worry that the integrity of the entire church is at stake. So look at politics, for example. There are Christians on both sides of the political spectrum. We might worry how God's kingdom could ever advance when there are Christians who hold opposing political views. But here's a hint, guys, the gospel is bigger than politics. Ooh. At the end of the day, Loft, these false teachers who are doing their best to destroy God's church, causing divisions and twisting doctrine, they cannot shake God's foundation. And it should not shake our confidence in the Lord. You see, here is a but God. We've been talking about but gods this last year. Ultimately, God knows those who are his. He is not tricked by these people claiming to have knowledge, claiming to speak for him, but instead just upsetting the faith. God doesn't get confused or sidetracked or distracted. Their empty arguments and the irreverent babbling, in the end, that is nothing more than a breath of air against the strong foundation of his kingdom. Imagine someone blowing on a building made of bricks and stone. Like, it does nothing. People like this might be dangerous for a time. They can even cause real damage in the lives of those who follow them. But in the end, they cannot thwart God and his church. And God's worker, God's approved worker, remembers this. And that empowers him or her to stay faithful to God's truth amid the noise of the world. God's worker remembers the gospel. God's worker avoids gospel distractions like quarreling and empty false claims. And God's worker preaches the gospel to themselves and to others in words and actions. Now, you might be left wondering, just questioning, well, how are we supposed to respond to quarrels and false teachings and people who are trying to distract from the gospel? That's coming up later in this series. I'm not going to talk about it today, but Paul does address it in this letter. I will leave you with just a few examples. The first one is a pastor and an author that I follow on social media. He posted this last week. He said, "I used to argue with others who didn't believe women could preach and pastor. So much energy wasted. Nowadays, I just train and provide opportunities for women to preach in our congregation. And when they do, hearts are changed, Jesus is glorified, and the church is edified." Amen. So he's not saying that we should never speak up for biblical truths or against false teachers. In fact, we definitely should. But what he's saying is, if you keep hammering the same thing over and over again and no one is getting it, turn around, look at your own life. Where are you missing opportunities to celebrate and demonstrate that gospel truth and to bless others by practicing it, instead of spending all your energy trying to convince people to change their minds about it? Which, that changing minds part, guys, is ultimately the work of the Holy Spirit. We need to avoid these gospel distractions. Now, that passage says they spread like gangrene. And you know what else spreads? Viruses. Yeah. So if false teaching is a virus, I want you to think about God's word like a vaccine. A vaccine goes inside of you and it teaches you, number one, how to recognize the virus or the bacteria and that doesn't belong in your body. And then number two, it teaches you how to fight against and get rid of those things. So God's word is like a vaccine. Except that we need to get God's word a lot more often than we need to get most vaccines. We need to continually be ingesting, or should I say injecting, God's word. Daily is good, multiple times a day. Get God's word in front of you, Loft. Get it inside of you, inside your mind and your heart. Only then will you be able to fight against these lies. So you might say, well, like, where's a good place to start? In the Bible. All scripture is God-breathed and profitable for instruction, but I might suggest, based on today, take a look at the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because in those, you're going to find a lot of examples of people asking Jesus questions, not out of interest in his message, but because they just want to trap him in what he says. There's like a variety of simple questions that people ask him, like, is it lawful to pay taxes? And then elaborate hypotheticals. So I want you to pay attention. If you go and read some stories about Jesus this next week, pay attention to how he responds when people ask him questions or say things that aren't in line with the truth of his message. Now, many times you will see him respond with gentleness and compassion, but other times don't seem so gentle. Sometimes he wields the word of God firmly like a sword to tear down and destroy strongholds of the enemy. So pay attention to that. We can learn so much from sitting at the feet of Jesus and learning from him. And just in closing, guys, I'm almost finished. I just want to encourage you once again, guys, hold on to God's word, stay faithful to it. You see, we are surrounded by so much noise, people promoting things that aren't true, people wanting to argue about things that don't matter, people trying to twist the truth of the gospel to suit their own desires. And we need to constantly remind ourselves of what the gospel is so that we can correctly identify what it is not. We need to constantly remind ourselves of the gospel because the devil is the father of lies, a deceiver who would like nothing more than for the worker of God to turn away from the truth and be caught up in things that oppose and subvert God's mission for the world. We need to constantly remind ourselves because every day in this world, we are bombarded with messages, internal and external, that compete not just for our attention, but for our allegiance. And guys, following Jesus is hard. You're gonna be tempted to give up at times. Sometimes it's our own sin that is tempting us and pulling away. And other times it's the external pressure and hardship. And that's one of the main messages, even in this letter of 2 Timothy. Paul is saying, even in hardship, even when it gets tough, remain faithful to God and to your work in ministry. Paul says, share in suffering. He even says, in the next chapter, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Guys, that's all who want to live a godly life, not just those Christians in the early church, not just Christians not outside of America. Paul says all. That includes us here in North Texas in 2021. If you devote your life to follow Jesus, there is going to be opposition. There's going to be hardship. And that's why we need to remain faithful to the gospel, because we need to remember if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. Jesus says, I am with you. That's part of the gospel. Jesus has reconciled us to the Father and given us his spirit, and he is with us. There will be trouble, guys, in this world. But Jesus says, I have overcome the world. I have conquered death, and I have made you conquerors too. All of your suffering here on earth, all of the hardship you endure in my name, it is worth it. It is producing eternal glory that may not be evident now, but will become evident one day. Jesus says, I am reserving a crown of righteousness for those who fight the good fight and keep the faith. Remain faithful. In the middle of suffering, remember me and the hope of my gospel. Let me pray for us. God, we are surrounded by so much noise in this world, and we feel pressed down and attacked from many different sides, God. And there's a lot of, even this week, there's so much heaviness that people are feeling. And but Lord, we have your truth. We have your word. We have your firm foundation that we can stand on, and we can have boldness and confidence, God. So I ask for you to open our eyes to your truth. I ask for your truth to penetrate our hearts and our minds even today. Reveal to us those things inside of us that are not part of your truth, God. Please open our eyes and may your spirit convict us so that we can see that gangrene that is growing inside of us. Give us confidence also and clarity to identify that gangrene that grows within your body of the church, God. And help us to avoid that, and help us to cut that off, God. Empower us to cut straight, to handle accurately your word, and to fight for you and your mission. And it's in your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Morgan. We're going to dive into communion, but what a great reminder for us to remember the gospel, to avoid gospel distractions, and that for us that we are called to preach the gospel in words and in our lives. It's not just about what we believe, it's about how we live it out. And so what a great reminder for us as followers of Jesus in this world that is looking for gospel people, that we are called to not just have our convictions, but we have to live out our convictions. And so thank you for speaking God's word to us. We're going to go into a time of communion, and then our Brother Christian is going to lead us in a time of song. And then afterward, if you're available, we'll go into breakout rooms. If not, you're welcome to go as well. But First John 4 says it this way: God's love was revealed among us in this way, that God sent his one and only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Love consists in this, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and that he sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us in this way, we must also love one another. And so if you have your elements this morning, I'm going to invite you to grab the bread. Would you pray with me this morning? Our Father, we thank you that the only reason we can sit here this morning and say we love you is because you loved us first. That you, in your goodness and kindness, lavished your love onto us through your Son, Jesus. And you, through your Holy Spirit, convicted us of our selfish wants, desires, and destruction of our lives. And you brought us into the family of God. Father, the only reason we're here is because of who you are and what you've done in our lives. And as we eat this bread this morning, we declare to you that we are grateful and thankful, and in worship, we celebrate what you have done in our lives. We love you. Let's eat together. If you have the juice, would you grab it? Father, we are so tempted to live our lives in a way that doesn't reflect you. That we might believe the truths of the gospel, but often sin and selfish desires and motives often dictate how we live our lives. And so God, as we drink this juice this morning, we declare to you that just as much as we are dependent on food and drink to sustain our moral bodies, we're absolutely dependent on you to continue to transform us, to make us into the image of Jesus. And so God, as we drink this juice today, we ask, remove those things in our lives that are not of you. Help us not to be people known for what we quarrel about, but help us to be people known as people that love Jesus with all of our hearts, souls, minds, and strengths, and help that we love our community as well. And so God, would you finish what you started in us? And to that end, we submit our lives into your hands and pray that you would have your way. We pray this in Jesus' name. Let's drink together. All right. As we close this morning, I'm going to invite our brother Christian to lead us in singing, and then I will do the benediction right after.
Fail and all the words are empty, and sin is all around and deep within. When we go astray, remind us of your mercy, help us call upon your name and be made whole. Oh, we come, Lord, we come as workers unashamed, standing firm upon the rock that is the glory of your name. May the spirit of your truth dwell in every word we speak, and the love of Christ that makes us new become the air we breathe. Oh, we come, remind us, Lord, of this, that we are one body, called to dwell within Christ's love that makes us whole. Lord, make us your vessel, purify our hearts, prepared to do your will and set apart. Oh, we come, Lord, we come as workers unashamed, standing firm upon the rock that is the glory of your name. May the spirit of your truth live in every word we speak, and the love of Christ that makes us new become the air we breathe. We come, oh, we come, we come, oh, we come, we come.
Amen. If you are looking to find where that song is on the internet, our brother Christian wrote that song last night in the context of this sermon. So phenomenal job putting together, and what a great debut for us. So thank you, brother, for writing that song and blessing our church community this morning. Friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, abide with each of us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless. Have a great week. If you're sticking around, we will open up breakout rooms. If not, have a wonderful week. We'll see you next week. God bless. Okay, I don't think there's enough people to do a breakout room, so we will hang out here. So, yeah. Here, if you want to stick around, so.